Oh, there is. Okay, right into it. All right. Good evening, everybody. My name is Teresa Sardelli. This is my husband, Mark. And we live at 216 East Adams Street here in town. And we wanted to address you about a nuisance tree that's in the boulevard in front of our house. There is a silver maple in front of our house that is growing up through the curbing in front of our house. It's causing damage to the curb. It's causing damage to the sidewalk. It's causing damage to the road. I have pictures if you'd like to see. In front of my house, yes, our house. 216 East Adams. Mm-hmm. We have pictures. I'm sorry, there's only one copy of them. So because it's on the boulevard, we were informed that it's a city tree, so we can't take it out ourselves. And so we wanted to address the council to find out if it would be possible to have the tree removed.
Kirby is aware of this tree,
okay.
And we've also talked to Phil about it. We do have a permit approved to remove the tree. What we're looking for is assistance from the city in the cost of removing the tree.
Okay. Just like to chime in real quick, removal of the tree will not cut. It would actually benefit, particularly when it comes to repairing the sidewalk and stuff, given that the tree is creating issues with the sidewalk.
Those sidewalks were just mud jacked. Was it last year, the year before when we did the mud jacking?
The year before.
And it's pushing the sidewalk back up again.
And there are pictures of the kind of show. There's a nickel kind of shows how much it's already come up.
And see, the roots are going in between the cracks and the
Yes.
curb.
Yes.
In addition to the damage that's there, it's causing the water to back up. It can't get to the storm drain, sits at the end of our driveway, and it's just rotting the road away. And Kirby's aware of that as well.
Okay.
The top layer of the blacktop's just coming off the road.
We did speak with L&E Tree Service, which is one of the tree services that I believe you use here in town. And we did receive a quote. He came out on Saturday and received a quote of $1,700 plus or minus to take the tree out.
And remove the stump also?
I think he said it would take it down to...
Down to ground level.
Ground level.
Yeah.
And I believe this is the same company that's working with the ash trees
mm-hmm.
that you're removing here in town. Another issue with the tree is it is causing problems with our sewer lines. We bought our house in 2018, and we've had to have a sewer company come out three times to a cost of over $2,000 to have the tree, and it's right there at the end, right 50 feet out?
48 feet from where they go in, which is right at the curb line.
Where the roots
are coming into the sewer lines.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I do have those receipts, too, if you'd like to see them.
Yeah, well, council certainly will take this seriously and visit with Kirby about it and look at what, you know, there are some rules dictating that I don't know how to start repeating them because I'm not going to do it after the
Understood.
At a cost share, but I'm not sure. We will put it down for an item under open discussion on the agenda, and then we can see what we can do.
That would be great.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time.
Those copies are for you guys to keep.
Okay. Amy, do you want these?
Yes.
wish to address the council at this time? Seeing none, we will move on to communications.
In your package, there's a copy of the planning and zoning and the EPA minutes from March. They said these are always in your package. You have a chance to review what other committees are doing. They don't need council approval of those minutes, and that's why in the back you can see them. But once the committee has approved them, they're going to be there. If you have questions about them, ask myself or the council member that is on that committee.
Any questions on those minutes? Move on to item 8, fire department report. Chief Lackenfern. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Amy, Council. So this month we started out the month getting our pictures taken for the update for the picture for the guidebook. I put in for a DNR grant last week for help, hopefully for new helmets. Friday I submitted a grant to Center Point Energy for hopefully we can get some money back, help us out to replace one of our monitors for monitoring like CO2 calls, whatnot. The one we've got currently, we're having issues with off and on. It's getting harder to get parts, so kind of be nice to have a backup, newer backup, I guess. I've got my chief officer positions all filled. Tom, Jeremy, they're sitting behind me. They have been coming and joining me at the last couple of meetings. Jim Klinkelhutz, he's actually showed up too. He's waiting out in the hallway. He started taking a new training officer job. I've got to open up the applications for another training officer. I'll do that at our next meeting night. So it'll be probably about a month with that rotation. We had our tanker one in and got the warranty work done on it. It was no cost to anybody. It was warranty work for a fuel rail on it. So that's all done now. All the other equipment, I think, has been pretty good all month long. Thank God. No bills. We had a meeting with Arlington Township. I think it was last week. They just had a couple simple questions about a few things, just rates or whatever, and kind of just wanted to meet. So I'm going to try and schedule actually meetings with all the townships just to get out and meet them and let them meet the new officers and whatnot. If they have any questions, hopefully we can get them answered and kind of start meeting everybody. So that's about all I got. Anybody have any questions?
Are you working on the grants and such? Are you working with your officers too, your assistant chief and everything, or showing them how they can do it or walking you through? I don't know the process, but I'm just wondering if you're including.
I haven't done these two yet. I'm kind of trying to figure it out myself yet. So the DNR grant was a pretty easy one just to fill out. It was only like a page. So, but I mean, I can pretty much go through them after they're done and kind of step them through it. But yeah, I mean, you can ask them. I've been keeping Jeremy and Tom pretty well filled in on everything as we've been going. So, the DNR grant I did, and I had to have Amy sign off on the Center Point one. So, basically, Center Point one was just, I had to kind of fill out like about an article on it, just why we could use it and why the community would benefit from it. So, but yeah, I'll get them going on some here at some point, I guess. So, yeah.
turn that on. A few things. First, start off with the March report from the police department. Everyone should have a copy, I believe, of this. Just our ICRs for the month of March. We could sit and go through them, but does anyone have any questions regarding the ICRs in March? Just a breakdown of calls and what the officers were working on. No? Okay. We'll put that off to the side for now then. Next thing I'd like to address is we've talked a few different times about opening up for an additional officer, a fourth officer. So I'm just bringing forward to the council a little bit more in depth about bringing a fourth officer on board, the mental health aspect of it. Right now there's 24-hour coverage, 7 days a week between two officers. Besides scheduled days off, they're on call or they're working. That doesn't leave a lot of time for personal life, besides, again, on their scheduled days off, which does not count for days where training is required, which is going to be annual training, taser, firearms, defensive tactics, use of force, chemical, baton. All that stuff is mandatory. So if it's your day off, you're still working. You're still coming in for training, as well as different patrol online classes that we're required to do. Depending on your licensing year, that's anywhere from 15 to 25 plus classes a year that you have to work on. And that you do while on duty, while taking calls and running traffic and still being out and visible to the public. Currently, the officers are definitely getting burnt out. Again, with 24 hours a day, 7 days a week between two people. That's asking a lot of those two people. Currently, right now, with no chief in place, there's definitely room on the budget to bring a fourth officer on for this year, and with next year's budget not even have been planned yet, and that'll be in June, July, where that's going to get looked at, we can definitely budget for that fourth officer. Retention, we talked about briefly last time I spoke with you. A sergeant's position is something good to look into down the road when we have like three full-time officers, all of them being off probation. That's a pretty big requirement. Maybe things to address as we move forward is a bonus, potential bonus for living in town. Can maybe look into the wages. That's a very hot topic right now in law enforcement. Maybe a hiring bonus with some type of clause set up that the officer's required to work for the department for a set period of time. Coverage rise with an additional officer, that'll help the night officers be on call for approximately 2 hours. And then the day car could take on call for, you know, a couple hours prior to their shift. That'll help alleviate a lot of burnout and stress. A day car would be on a rotating schedule, which would cover two weekends a month as well. So the chief could take, on call as a call car 1 day 1 week and 2 days the next week. Well, actually, you'll gain coverage with having a day officer on weekend coverage as well. The day car also could be on a rotating schedule, and that's something where I would discuss with the officers, but like if it's a 4 month rotation schedule where you're on nights for 4 months, you go to days, then you go to the other rotation for nights, and everyone kind of circles. So everyone's going to do 4 months out of the year as a day car. Possibly in the future as well, if we look at getting a part-time officer as well, that part-time officer could just cover day shifts on the opposite weekends of the full-time day car. So that's going to give us coverage for 7 days a week. And that's just something to look into in the future as we move ahead. With a lot of that being said, I definitely would like to address the council and ask the council to make a motion to bring a fourth officer back to Arlington. And I would also ask the council to approve that motion so we could move forward and get something posted and get the process started. Because it doesn't take a week. It does take some time to go through the hiring process and training process of a new officer.
I understand that. I support a fourth officer, but I do think we should wait for our new chief to take over, get settled in, and let him decide if we need one or not. And you added him on to the end of our agenda. We'll get to that then, but I'm not against the fourth officer. I've said that many times, but I do think we should wait for the new chief to make that recommendation also.
Is there a requirement to have the on-call coverage? You noted the 24-hour day coverage, and I just made an assumption that, being that we were down, a chief and had the two officers, I was assuming that we were having gaps in coverage. So is it required in our city statute to provide that 24-hour day coverage?
No. If we're not on call, then if there's a call for service, then we're not going to be around to take that call, and that's something anyone in the public would not like to see. And there would be potentially a deputy on duty that would start over this way, but then the Arlington officer is getting called out to handle the call as he would be primary officer. What was the time frame? Like, how long ago was that?
Not more than, when did we bring in 3 or 4 officers? 5 years ago, 6 years ago?
Because even what 5 years ago was isn't what today is.
Arlington hasn't changed in 5 years as far as size, anything, really. I know times have changed, but the size and the scope of Arlington hasn't changed from what it was.
Even much. The bookkeeping, we had a, what I'm hearing is, part-time, person doing part-time work there, part-time work, for the city, and that was with 2 officers, so.
And then the administrative?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That was never before, but it was 2 police officers or 2 police officers.
What,
that?
And
they didn't have.
They were doing their own book work, too.
Yeah. They've been there for, 3 years?
Mm-hmm. 2 years.
I think there were gaps.
That's what I was assuming, that we had gaps in coverage because we only had 2. That was my assumption. During the less busier times of the night or whatever.
Maybe 2 o'clock through 7:30 there wasn't any coverage? 2 o'clock in the morning?
Just being out in this general area for, almost, I suppose, getting closer to 5 years now. Most of the call-outs are going to be between probably 3 and 5 is what I've always mostly been called out for domestics, and it could be anything, a really bad car accident, like AM. Yep.
So, so,
So, I mean, it's, you can't put a, we can't put a time frame on it, because a domestic comes 24 hours a day. It's irrelevant on time.
Over there, and there's nobody in the middle of the eastern end of the country. And they can't cruising through Arlington at the time domestic call comes in. So the county attorney's, the county sheriff's office is there as a protection for us, but it's not quite as close a protection as our own police department is.
Just more of a curious question. Has the deputies been helping out? Because I've been noticing them a lot on the weekends. You know, there's two of them kind of camp all on five. Almost every weekend, but we haven't seen. So they've been helping out more now that we're done with it too, or they just, is that something they've been doing on their own?
That's just something they've been kind of doing on their own to, you know, like help. You know, if you know, our officers are newer. You know, so just you know, helping out with you know guidance and you know, just basically just trying to help out. It's not something they're required to do. But it is something that, that they're doing.
Right, and I'm just saying that, you know, with the problem that they have in the county, but like I said, for the last month, I've seen two of them every weekend parked up on five together. I guess, I mean, it's something we can discuss and look into. If as long as it's justified, and you know, they want 24/7, you know, they need 24/7 service. I still go back to why the fourth officer was brought on in the first place, which didn't pan out in the school.
That was the pushing.
That was the whole push
that
for
was
four
the
officers.
Reason for
not the 24-hour coverage, but for the school.
And I definitely could understand the on-call part of it, and I think that is going to be a challenge for you know maintaining other officers. Trying to figure out if that if we need to justify having that on call to where that those officers can't have their own vocally. You know, and I've made it vocally known that, you know, obviously I support having three officers, a total of three officers. I also support having a part time person to cover the hours for those three officers to be able to take vacations. But it's just never, you know, been brought up or in my opinion, maybe even looked at. It's more or less been kind of, well, no, it's either this or nothing at all, which would add up to, you know, somewhere around 600 hours, if I did the math correct, 600 or 800 hours based on our total vacations for those three officers. Depending on how many years that they would be with us. So essentially annually, you know, let's say we had a part-time person that was capable of filling, whether it was vacations or events that we have going on to add additional coverage for us. And obviously I understand that poses challenges, but I just feel like it hasn't really been really seriously looked at. It's either we're going to go to four or, you know, hey, they're not listening to us, I'm going to do it.
Well, again, from a historical perspective, we did have at one point quite an active roster of part-time officers. I think that started with Dan Gold, the state chief. And part of answering your question, how did we divide the two officers all those years? Well, in way back, you know, again, I think there were fewer demands. The society was different. You know, drugs weren't as much of an issue and so on. But then as we got into kind of the middle phase, say going back 20 years, 15 years, we had the two officers plus a lot of part-timers. And what we were experiencing in more recent years, and perhaps the chief can comment on this, it was darn hard to find reliable part-time officers at a certain point. You know, we would get them on the roster, and then when we wanted to schedule them, somehow they weren't available. I recall in particular one part-time officer that we felt really used Arlington to get their training updated, et cetera, and then somehow they were never available to actually serve. So I think that in more recent years, some of the chiefs became disgusted with that, and it, there's a lot of extra work for them to, you know, schedule a part-time officer for this coming weekend. They call this one, no, sorry, I'm busy. Call that one, no, I can't do it. You know, and then eventually, maybe just, you know, have to have one of the full-time officers serve after all. Now, if you get a good part-time officer who's willing to stick around, you know, that's like finding gold, you know, unless things have changed. But I suspect it's gone the opposite direction with the crisis we're experiencing with the staffing of police. What's your comment about part-timers?
Currently, right now, anyone looking for a law enforcement job currently is definitely looking for full-time employment. And we've brushed on wages and stuff, and right now there's a lot of things going in a lot of different directions in law enforcement right now.
I'm just wondering if there's someone that's relatively new starting out, and maybe they're not getting overtime in their community, and they have some time that they would be able to serve another. Where I look at it, they're already licensed, they're already working, potentially maybe even in the area.
There's a lot of new officers in the area. So there's still a lot of officers on probation. So when you're on a probationary period, typically you're not going to work for another agency while you're on probation, typically. I can't give you a definite yes or no on that, but from what I know, typically you're going to work for one agency while you're on a probationary period, which lasts 12 months.
That was another issue that came up when we had an active part-timer roster, that a part-timer, for example, would respond to a domestic on a weekend, but then they went off to their full-time job, and one of our full-time officers would have to pick up the investigation and witness interviews, etc. And then also part-timers tended to be very tardy in submitting their backup paperwork, the investigation results. And there were a few situations that created a real problem, because in the criminal justice system, we have some very firm deadlines for various steps of the investigation and the prosecution. And if you miss a deadline, it gives a defense attorney a very good reason to have a case thrown out. And we did experience that happening on a few occasions. I can remember one part-time officer in particular. This was some years ago, and I can't remember what he had going on in his life, but I think we had two or three cases thrown out because we could never get a hold of him, couldn't get him to submit his paperwork, and it just wasn't the way things were supposed to work. Now, I can also remember some part-time officers that are excellent, where again, if you find a good one who's willing to stick around, it's like, you know, finding gold. Theoretically, it's the ideal situation. If we feel four full-time officers is too much, and maybe three is too little, you know, get that 3.5 by having a good, reliable part-time officer. But the trick is, especially in this day and age, finding that guy or that gal to plug into the position. That could be an ongoing issue.
Currently, I think that would be, I would agree. It's the timing isn't, we're not in the time for a part-time officer right now. That's something, you know, probably realistically even a couple years down the road, with getting just this department established with a new chief and three officers, get everybody trained up and running and established before looking into a part-time officer. Just where law enforcement currently is, nobody's looking for a part-time position. Everyone's looking for full-time.
I mean, honestly, it doesn't hurt to ask for a part-timer if we don't care for a part-timer and see what we get. I mean, if we wanted to try and help a little bit as far as that goes and see if we get any hits on it.
Well, we've heard Interim Chief Denley wishes that council would take a stand on the fourth officer position. Chief Administrator Newsom has talked to our potential new chief, who also stated they would like to see a fourth officer. So I think the dangerous part is saying no to that, because we could lose our potential.
And again, just to remind the council, this is a lengthy process to even bring a patrol officer on. It's not something that would be settled next week. The hiring process is quite a process. With the background, it could take several months.
In good conditions, with a lot of availability, it probably takes a couple months. And now it's good.
Correct.
Thinking more on this, being a small town, and the more I think about it, we're going to be a revolving door anyways. You know, they'll come here, get experience, move on to bigger and better things probably. So either way, we'll have four full-time officers for a while, but then next, how do we got to figure out a way to keep them too? But I don't think that's
that
other opportunities.
That's just not a small town
right.
issue anymore. There's departments in the metro that people are leaving making over $40 an hour because they can go to another department and get $52 an hour. So it's every department is dealing with this, where people are leaving like that unexpectedly.
Well, we certainly don't want to advertise for a fourth position and get a bunch of applicants that aren't qualified. I mean, I think there's a lot of them there.
They're all qualified.
Well, they're all qualified, but would we want them over? And we know that, yeah. That's it or not. So.
Well, I mean, we have to decide if we want to have a fourth officer department, yes or no, period. Because I don't agree with hiring one and then knowing that you're always going to have three, because that's not being honest with everybody that's here.
Well, no. And
or the chief, that's
not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that
that's what it
when it's all said and done, you get four officers, but eventually, again, you don't know how long that.
start getting into policy and setting exactly how he's going to run the department, you don't think that's going to irritate?
Well, there's the budget side of things, and that's where the council comes in.
Yeah.
Decide what that budget is. I think it's on the council to decide the 3 versus 4.
I think it is too. But not set policy.
Well, so if we as we have decided in the past that we were going to be 3 officers, now that seems to be, that does go back and forth, and it has changed.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, when you're at 3, that leaves more burden on, and then we have heard the on-call is and has been and continues to be a an issue. I'm guessing that there's some that maybe don't want to do any on-call, or it makes it more difficult. So that's where the talking about what is required, and what do we require of the police department for something.
So
when it comes to on-call.
In theory, if there was 4 officers, there'd be no officer would be on-call. They'd just be a set schedule, and that's it, is what the department would look like then.
With a day car, they could split the on-call, the hours of the morning. When, like, if nobody was on duty, the night car could take would be on-call for, like, 2 hours. Then the day car could take on-call for 2 hours prior to the start of their shift. And they'd kind of split the responsibility of on-call. And then just go on their schedule from there.
I don't think we had 24-hour, 7-day-a-week coverage until John Edison came on board with 3 additional officers, so it's 4 total. And since he left, since we're less than 4, we didn't cut back. And I agree with you. I was under the impression that we've got 2 officers, so we also cut back on time so they could handle it. I really was surprised to hear you say that we're on 24-7 coverage. I don't expect that of 2 officers. I really don't. And I don't think it's good. So I think this is important as making a decision on the fourth officer. You have to look at those hours too. If you decide to stick with 3, then you're going to seriously look at cutting back the hours. I know I've had Pete comment and he said, what, 10 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday? Why do you have to have somebody patrolling?
It's a
valid.
It is.
Still plenty of impaired drivers at 10 a.m. on Sunday, just like on a Friday night at midnight. Time of day and day is irrelevant. People still drive impaired. People still attack their spouses. People still assault their friend. Time's irrelevant. Day of the week is irrelevant. People still die in automobile accidents Sunday morning, 10 a.m., just like they would 2 in the morning Thursday.
When's your most active period? I'm going to make an assumption is a period from when the bar is closed until
for impaired drivers is what you're focused on?
I'm sure there's information out there that says what the hospital is.
Yeah, there's stats that are kept, I guess, as far as, impairment by alcohol.
I mean, I could be driving to work and someone in the other lane who didn't get enough sleep and they're driving to work crosses over and, there's a lot of different scenarios.
Correct.
So if we went ahead and did this before the officer, so he's coming in eventually, how does that affect the budget for the department for the rest of the year?
Well, that's what he stated. He stated that there's obviously money in there. And it's just that when I make the
something I don't want to see happen, you know, when we start looking at, we're going to be looking at budgets here in a few months, a year, and what's going to end up happening is we always try to keep it as low as possible, but the one department that gets cut is Kirby's, and we just see now we can't keep cutting that department because of other ones, so we're going to have to, with the hiring of a fourth officer, everybody's going to have to understand that it's going to cost.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the part that is missing from the survey. So if you send out a survey and say, well, this is our coverage, and you got to evaluate the dollars and cents to what it means
right.
when we're saying it.
Okay, we've got to move on. I think we've expressed a lot of opinions. Is there someone that wishes to make a motion to?
I'll make a motion to table the discussion that I mentioned earlier. Table it, have a workshop, send out a survey, come back, make a decision.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion by Councilmember Batcher, second by Councilmember Miller, to table the decision on fourth police officer. Further discussion. Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. One dissenting vote. Right, anything else, Chief?
All right. Nope. That was going to do it for me.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hello. How is everyone? That's good to hear. All right. Let's get the easy one out of the way when it comes to the community center report. Not much to report. The only big thing that happened this previous month was the Republican convention for our district 17 B and A happened here. Nothing really to report there. It went smoothly. I was here to make sure everything went well. I'm going to address that is it worked when I set it up. For some odd reason it wasn't working that day. I'm looking into it. Granted that the city administrator addressed that, so we're currently looking into that. Minus technical difficulties, everything else went fine. To get on to the more serious notes when it comes to the P&Z report, back in March, I introduced there was a developer that presented a plan for 54 units near the Frenzel Pondview area at the cul-de-sac of Pondview Drive, the two parcels at the end of the cul-de-sac where the stormwater pond is. They wanted to build 54 units. We had a public hearing on it. Needless to say, the public was not in favor of it. Because of that, and because of the negative input from the community, the 54 units have pulled out. So, however, that has not deterred the P&Z to address the rezoning issues of it. So tomorrow we are going to address, the committee is going to address the rezoning recommendation from the High Island Creek developers for it based on certain plans that were presented that were created in 2004. Beyond that, moving on to another more serious note, good news is that the planning and zoning code I've finalized the edits for it. With that, the committee last meeting has asked me to request to move the fence code because that was also, there was conversation about in March of updating the fence or city chapter. With that, while I was doing edits to the fence chapter, I came across that the outdoor parking and storage in chapter 6 of the nuisance city code actually should be in the zoning code, given that it's more of a zoning review and zoning issue. So with that, the P&Z committee last meeting has requested me bring this to council to make a motion to incorporate both the fence code and outdoor parking and storage into the zoning chapter.
On the fence code with chapter 17, which only contains fence related,
correct.
Would that just go away?
It would go away, but that doesn't mean that it pretty much all the edits that I did and everything. So chapter 17 will technically go away as a city code. It will just be incorporated into the zoning code. Okay. So because based on chapter 17, it requires a land use permit. And if when someone would build a fence, I would actually have to go out and inspect it, not the building official. So therefore it's overall a zoning issue. So from what the committee has discussed last meeting, it would make more sense to have it in the zoning code than keep it as its own separate thing.
I discussed this with Philip, and the fence ordinances are always separate from the zoning ordinance, and I don't know why. That even predates me. When I put together the code, since the body of fence ordinances are separate from the zoning code, I just put it into a separate chapter. And the same thing with the outdoor parking. There's a set of ordinances that have been passed over the decades on that subject, and it was not incorporated in the zoning code. When Philip brought it up, I thought that makes sense, because what's contained in the fence portion of the code and the outdoor parking portion of the code would normally be in zoning ordinance or zoning chapter. So it's more of an administrative question. I have no problem with it. And we could certainly, not to renumber the entire code, I think that was
how that's it really what I was getting at.
Yes, we could just have a chapter 17, it used to be the fence chapter, and just say available for future use.
Yeah, right.
I mean, we right now, I leave it at how City Council wants to deal with Chapter 17, but from what I've talked to the committee on, because ultimately, when it comes to fences, it really relies on me, because it would require a land use permit, and once one of the P&Z members, they recommended that we move forward amending the fence code. Once I did amend it, and they saw the amendments I did, and they had no objection to it, they've came to the conclusion that it made more sense to incorporate it into the zoning code, because based off pretty much how we're structuring and everything and the information that I've gathered on surrounding towns, it just made more sense. It was the same with the outdoor storage and parking, because if you look at that particular section, it addresses that I would have to do the reviews and do the inspections, i.e. also if they did violations. So.
Further discussion. Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. Okay, next one, approve or deny planning and zoning request to move outdoor parking and storage to chapter 31.
Make motion to move outdoor parking and storage to chapter 31.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion by Councilmember Batcher, second by Councilmember Sharpe, to move to the outdoor parking and storage portion of the code to chapter 31. All in favor say aye.
And just to pivot off that, with given that you guys made the motion, the next, not obviously tomorrow, we will finalize on tomorrow's meeting, the special council P&Z meeting, which I encourage, and if you guys have the time to come, because we'll be talking about the final, pretty much the finalization of our code right now. And with these motions, we will move forward, and if everything's okay, next meeting, following next month, we will do a public hearing on the updates that I've created for the P&Z code. And we will, by the mid of next month, we will have our updated P&Z code.
What time is the meeting?
It is at 7 o'clock. Yes. And we also will be talking about, I know that, I also want to mention before I forget, I know there's been talks in EDA and particularly council about housing and stuff. We will discuss that as well, given the pretty much after the what happened with the hearing of the 54 units, we will be discussing that as well. So I greatly encourage you guys to come to it and give your input and everything to it.
Is that exempt during winter?
Currently, right now, you can park. They can park it during the winter, but it has to be at least 80% covered. I either have to have a cover over it that.
Well, I'm talking. Okay, let's. Cause it, you know, no more vehicles on the front, on, you know, on the lawn areas, front or backyard. Say we have a storm or something. Somebody's got to park. You know, think you can. You know, they got to get the cars off the street or get ticketed or towed. So they park it on there.
Well, based on past precedents that I'm dealing with now, obviously, I'm currently still looking to amend this, but as it stands right now, this is pretty, in my opinion, it's pretty solid. From what I'm looking at on the winter, when it comes to, since I've been here for at least one winter, if you have like an RV or something, like a trailer or anything,
right,
on the streets during the winter, yes, we will create an issue for it. But if it's on your actual... Right.
Number two. So, you know, no motor vehicle designed to operate on a public highway, car, truck, etc. You know, because you'll need to be parking your lawn. You have snow emergency.
Well, it. Yeah, it. I'll be honest with you. That's a pretty loose thing. So, the way I've been doing is based on my interpretation. Because in reality, if you have a truck, like let's say you have a 350. That has a snow plow on it that you personally own, but yet you outsource to like do snow plowing and stuff. I'm not. It's more of a the way I've been dealing with it right now, and I have to still look into this. It's a case by case basis. I kind of been letting it go unless it creates a massive public nuisance to people. I really wish I could give you a better answer,
I'm
Matt. Right.
I got soon four vehicles. Okay, something's got to go on the lawn.
And
have people been getting ticketed for it?
Not that I know.
No, and
but if it's in the ordinance,
right. And I'll be honest with you, I've been slightly lenient on that because right, no, it does, because from what I'm accustomed to, particularly back out east, it was very cut and dry. You know, you would have enough space. Here, I don't know how to put it other than there's certain circumstances where you guys more or less, I'm still trying to understand the vehicle process here, and I've been kind of lenient on it because I'm trying to get better info on it. So with that, unless someone physically complains to me and I have to look into it to see if it becomes a serious public nuisance, I've been letting it lie. However, it's something that I am in the process of addressing. So
the couple that I've seen multiple times on when the snow emergency pops up, the comments, because I do check them just to kind of see what's kind of out there. You know, essentially the person works, you know, an hour away.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because of their vehicles. So I think, like, as we're designing these policies, and I think Matt brings up a pretty valid point that in the wintertime, you know, if they know it's in the forecast of snow, they could save
right.
themselves a ticket or to be in the way of the snowplow and plowing, that they could park on their lawn.
And with that, this is the... And that's the I hate to admit it, I can't be everywhere 24/7 in order to.
No, I'm not relying on you.
No.
I'm just saying that as we're developing this policy, we
right.
put ourselves in the
No, you're 100% right, Joe, but in order for me to put my in that seat, I also have to be able to monitor that to see. I have to be able to gather data on it to see how it's being approached. Because I've had people call. Like, I literally had a few people call when we had a snow emergency, and they've called me expressing, well, I'm not going to be able to move my car in the appropriate time. And I told them, well, I'm sorry, I have to stick to the policy. This is X, Y, and Z. If you can't move it, then we'll address it from there. It's
no, but I think, again, going back to what Matt has stated, that, you know, here we are trying to, you know, make it suggested at this point, but if it's frozen out and you know, there's going to be a snow emergency or possibility of snow, if they can just...
If I need to...
Yeah, we're getting off.
Yeah,
we're
not right.
It was more just to bring up to planning and zoning.
Right. Right, and I, and pivoting off that, well, and you're 100% correct, and from what I've looked at, looking at this, particularly this section of what will be incorporated into the zoning code, obviously there still needs to be some minor tweaks to it because of, obviously, the of certain X, Y, and Z. However, right now, I think we'll be in a good position to approve it right now, and as moving forward, we can easily tweak that. It'll be easy to tweak that once we finally finalized everything in the code, once we get everything stabilized, and then from there I can make minor tweaks. This, in my opinion, will be minor, but right now we should focus on overall hauling it, because given that we have an increase in development and we're focusing on that stuff, it's good to have a stable zoning code right now with the majority of changes that we need right now. And this, in my opinion, is a minor tweak.
Mm-hmm. All right. Anything else, Phil?
Nope, that's all.
Okay. Anything else for Phil? All right.
All right, thank you.
Sure. Okay, so this is, yeah, are we just doing the one, or should I run through them all? Oh, all of them? So, the
20.5 for the next one.
Okay. Patching bids, I would like, so I bid Bargain and RCM. RCM came out cheaper overall, but I kind of sliced them and diced them up a little bit to get the best of both. Some of the spray patch I don't think would work with some of the areas. It would be better with a heat patch. So I'm hoping that we can use both. So $9,800 for Bargain, and then total for RCM was $37,350. And I would hope we could approve both of those. That's like my yearly budget for maintenance. Right, right. Yeah, and you guys had already approved the chip seal. I did have to cut some of that back just so we could keep up on some of the maintenance to make the chip seal worth it. But yeah, I guess the total for the entire kind of what I want to get done and is that $148,827. But with that spray patch too, they'll be able to go around town and do the rest of our potholes. So they would do some outside of the project as well. Yeah, for sure. Yep. Matt, Dave's. Don't forget Dave's. Those are priorities. Yeah, it's a bad one. I hate to fill it because I know it's got to be filled by the spray patch yet. Correct. Yeah. Correct. Yeah, so if we go, the chip seal, we're done. We did that.
Councilman Batchelor, second by Councilman Meyer, to approve the recommendation from State Supervisor Kirby. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no.
I'll make a motion for the gap magic by Bargain.
Councilmember Morgan, second by Councilmember Thomas, to approve the bid from the gap mastic from Bargain. Is it Bargain or Bargain?
Bargain.
Bargain?
Yep.
Okay. And that is a $43,280. Further discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
No? Motion carried.
We haven't done Crackville. That was just the chip. Yep.
Second.
that should wrap it up for me.
With the council's permission, I would like Kirby to comment on the topic earlier.
Sure. Yeah, right. Yeah, I mean, anytime we could take a maple, soft maple or a silver maple out, I'm all for that. I mean, it's a healthy tree yet, but it's right on top of their sewer line. Our budget is all used up. Yeah. It's a healthy tree yet, but considering it's going to grow to be two or three times bigger than that, and then cost us two or three times more us to take down. But I think something we have to take, I'd have to take a good look again. Our bucket, yeah, right? I don't know if I can answer that. Our bucket is limited to the height. That's so I'm kind of limited to medium to small trees. I could look at it. One thing I want the council to consider, I mean, I jumped all in with, you know, when I talked to him about it, I thought, yeah, you know, hey, if it costs us half the price when it's a smaller tree, sure, but to weigh out a precedence we might set is, you know, if people all of a sudden, everybody wants their trees out. I mean, that. Yeah, well, that's true. It's very, it's a good case. It's a solid case, true. Mm-hmm. Okay. I had never, I guess I never caught that. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We were approached when we were doing the tree inventory. A fellow came out in front. He said, I'd just like to take that tree down. And, you know, that's basically, he wanted it down because he didn't like the tree.
Sure.
He didn't do any damage.
Okay.
So,
okay. Okay.
This one obviously is doing some damage.
Okay. Think so.
I just think that's administrative waste of time and cost.
Well, they filed, just because they filed for the permit, I reviewed it. It's obviously, it wasn't that big of a deal. It was an over-the-counter review. It was pretty straightforward. They provided pictures and everything of it, which they presented to you guys.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Was there a fee associated with that?
Was there a fee associated with
No, there wasn't, because it didn't.
So
we don't have anything in our code that would assess a fee, so I figured just they're going to represent, just put it on record.
I think the council is, the consensus is just take the tree down.
Okay.
Yeah.
Long term costs of repairing that curve is quite often.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
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 Anything else for Kirby?
Thank you.
Yeah, just to, real brief, from my research that you all requested from me, I, instead of creating like this long drawn out policy from when I talked to the league about and things, it'd been simpler just to create a little paragraph in our policy, just breaking down what we've done and everything and talking to the personnel committee. They seem pretty satisfied with it. And if you guys have any questions, I'd be gladly to answer them. And I want to stress, I do apologize for it being long. I will gladly cut it down. It's just what they recommended from the League of Minnesota's. Exactly. I took their I took their template, and it was. I even stressed that this is kind of long. They're like, well, this is what we've done, did the research on. So I'm like, I wasn't going to argue with them over it. So. Sorry, just to interject, it was mainly parking was the major issue. There was major fear that, given that they weren't able to meet the parking requirements based on zoning standards, that they would end up be parking on the streets and it would create congestion that could not withstand on that street. That was one of the major pushbacks. Also drainage as well, that they didn't think that the, based off the plans that were presented from People Services, that they, that proper drainage would not sustain for those 54 units and therefore create flooding.
To get to the apartment site, you would have to drive through the
rest. Right. Right. There was talk about expanding, if you see on the map, expanding the road out to County 9, but there was no guarantee that that would actually happen. They would like to see it, but I can't say what the county or what the developers would want to do, so I could not say yes or no to that. The high density was supposed to go where, as you see right here, this is where it was projected based on the plans back in 2004. However, that's not the important part right now. The important part was creating the bringing the 54 units at the two parcels right here. And they, like I said, they had major concern because of access to this area and heavy traffic and parking.